I may be publishing some of this stuff online, but I'm going to go over it here. So this is, as I'm reading this to you, this is not intended to have a companion. You're not supposed to be looking at my website, reading along with notes as I go. I am reading notes that may eventually become some sort of a post in a different format, which I might go over later. I've come to the conclusion, after going back and forth and round about Eastern Asian shame, we're talking about specifically, maybe there could be others, but specifically we're talking Chinese, Korean, Japanese shame culture. I've come to the conclusion that this shame culture is a combination, a consortium of personality disorders. It's a macro social disorder. Now, I'm not an expert. I'm not a licensed psychologist, so I'm not pretending to be an expert. I'm talking about what I've seen and what I've read. My mother was a social worker licensed under DSM-3, so I grew up with psychobabble in the house. And I love reading about topics, and I love understanding. In fact, I've got this argument that we should have community psych. I think that the American Psychiatric Association, the guys that they do the DSM. It's the shrink Bible. It's the psychobabble dictionary. What is a disorder, and you know what's mental health and what's not and stuff. And that's where the terminology comes from. So if someone uses some psychobabble and you want to know what it means, you need the DSM. Now there's the DSM, the big, huge, enormous thing. That's like the type of thesaurus that you could kill someone with, you know, this huge, enormous book, something that looks like Gandalf would want to read. But then, there's the desk reference, which is a little spiral bound thing for about $40. And that can be a little bit more concise. Now I've only perused these, and I would love to have my own desk reference one day when I get the time to open it up, because I'm that busy. But DSM, psychobabble, personality disorder is a set of behavior judged to be enduring, inflexive, maladaptive, disturbing, and impaired social functioning. Basically, it's really bad and it never changes. No matter what happens, someone with a personality disorder will never change. It's to save their own lives. Someone can point a gun to their head and say, pick up the pencil, not the pen, and they won't do it. Or they'll do it melting down, crying emotionally, totally distraught, and afterwards they will take vengeance on you in any and every way possible for the rest of their lives, and they'll never forgive you for being so cruel. Totally incapable of adapting or changing or learning or modifying their opinion on something. Totally incapable. And it's like disturbing stuff, and it really damages relationships. And they're very abusive physically, emotionally. I mean, they bully people. They attack people. They harass people. Personality disorders. So again, a set of behavior judged to be enduring, inflexible, maladaptive, disturbing, and impaired social functioning. I got that from Myers. Now, a complex is different. A complex, as I understand, a complex is a complete set of emotions, memories, perceptions, and wishes of the personal unconscious organized around a common theme. Now, that's what I picked it from Wikipedia. Sorry, I don't have an exact source, but I certainly hope it's from DSM. Now, but this is not my invention. This is what the shrinks will say. All respect to the shrinks, including Jordan Peterson. A complex can be anything. Theoretically, a psychotherapist can invent a complex to describe a mental patient in the office on the spot, in theory. Like they can just come up with a complex. There's a numerous numbers, infinite, countless, theoretically infinite, of a complex. Like a Napoleon complex, a Messiah complex, a father complex who's got to be the benevolent father to everyone, the mother complex who has to be the loving mother to everyone, the Oedipus complex where the son loves his mother too much. It's just weird. Like, what in the world? Like mama's boy complex. You could, the Napoleon complex is the government leader who's got to keep conquering and doing more and more and more, but a little bit of a celebrity. Like, it's got to be, you've got to be kind of a famous person for that to develop. It's like there's you can look at all these. It's the complex, as I understand it, the way I see it when I learn about a complex. The complex is you've got La La Land that you're all dreamied up in, and you've become this character that you've invented that you've always hoped to be, how you've always probably misunderstood the world is dealing with you. Good, bad, definitely grandiose, definitely overdone and overbaked. There were arguments that Obama had a messiah complex. Trump, arguably, people might argue, trying to be fair, not critical, Trump might have a Daddy Warbucks complex. People might argue. I don't know about that. It may be a New York slugger complex, probably. Well, how he just hits back reflexively. But I'm not going to try to put Trump on the couch. I'm trying to be objective because I said something bad about Obama. But the messiah complex argument, I think, you know, he was the savior. I think that probably sticks a little bit better than trying to label Trump with something. Trump's just a guy that's irritable at times and smart and made a bunch of money and stuff. So we have to be careful with trying to diagnose people and act like experts. I'm not an expert. I've just read this stuff and I know what I've seen. Now, I would love for the APA, the American Psychiatric Association, they govern the DSM. Now we're on DSM-5. They govern the Shrink Bible, the Shrink Dictionary. I'd love for them to get a community psychology course and offer it to people in Taiwan in English. You've got it. It's only in English. It's only in English. And the person needs to pass an English test in order to get this community psych. Knowledge of crazy. There's not much of it in the world. Many people throughout the world don't recognize crazy. Just, oh, he's angry. Well, let's not fight him or he'll be mean to us more. And they're the home gets beat down by the crazy one in the house. And that happens all over the world and people just come to accept it. And it's not healthy. And so I'd love to see the APA have, just like the Red Cross has community CPR. It doesn't make you an expert, but it makes you competent enough that you can respond. If you make a mistake, you're governed by Good Samaritan laws. It's just to promote general good knowledge. I think it'd be great for a lot of supervisors or managers, a general manager of a restaurant, to take the community psych course, understand what crazy is and what crazy is not, when to get professional help, a little bit of psychotherapy technique to know how to talk to people when they're crazy. Just a little bit of public general knowledge. People know they're not professionals, but you're empowering them with a little bit more understanding. You cannot die. This is diagnosing someone as a fake professional. This is an imposter. This is just you sharing your opinion as a lay. And, you know, that should be in the training. I would love to see community psych as teaching for this. So, a complex is this imaginary theater. The person doesn't know that they're not on stage. Now, we're not talking about the actor who never quits. That's a personality disorder, but that's a complex. And there can be infinite number of complexes. You can invent them to describe a problem in someone, but it's got to be like an enduring, continuing, real problem to actually be a complex. The personality disorder, there's only 10. And they fall into three clusters. Cluster A has paranoid personality disorder. And see, I'm shy in water. So I'm going to make like Jordan Peterson and drink water so that I can get my brain working. Pardon my French. You know, the French belch at the dinner table, so that's French. I've got my little driving cap. I believe it's called a Burmese. They were supposedly invented in Birmingham, so I've got a Burmese. I've defined two words at Urban Dictionary, by the way, and Burmese was one of them. All right. The personality disorder cluster is off the top of my head. Paranoid personality disorder is, you know, person's paranoid. A lot of projection. They imagine other people want to do to them what they would do. If If that were me doing that, I would want this. So therefore he wants that. Well, maybe not, but they don't know that. They think everyone's motives are their own motives. So there's a lot of super paranoia, super paranoia. I know two ladies in Taiwan that I just, it's just what I read fits them. And they both have these bug eyes, like their eyes bulge out of their heads. And they're, I've seen that before in paranoid people. PPD, paranoid personality disorder, and schizoid, which is kind of like semi-schizophrenic ish, maybe. I'm not going to define it because it refers to other knowledge. And then schizotypal, where someone really acts schizophrenic even though they're not. Something like that. That's cluster A, and that's the weird. That's the weird, scared, hot, cold type of cluster. Then there's cluster B. It's got four personality disorders. And this is the theatrical, dramatical, antisocial. Now, I argue that there's conditioned antisocial and biological antisocial. But basically antisocial, they can't connect to events in time. They don't know cause, effect. I lie so they don't trust me tomorrow. That's antisocial. They can't get that. They don't get that. And with kids, playing with fire, cruelty to animals, bedwetting are the signs. But the parent, there's research, C. Marvin Pate, one of my profs at Moody, research, someone has antisocial, you can help that person overcome that by helping them connect the dots. So with the children, it's got to be a lot of, there was a kid in Taiwan, I flagged him for antisocial at 4 years old. All my lay opinion, I'm not a professional. I flagged him for it. And I told the mother what I thought. She said, go have at it, Jesse. And I would properly, healthily spank the kid. I would not beat him. Marks wouldn't last more than a few minutes. And I would talk to him, and he slowly came out of it. And he still has some of it, but he's much better functioning and not as disturbing. And I got that from what C. Marvin Pate, my Bible professor, had read in some psych journals, and he'd published with his wife in a book, that you can help them, but you got to help them connect the points in time. Pathological liar, we're talking another story, and I don't know much about that, but I've seen this. So I think that it can be conditioned and biological. Conditioned antisocial is where the parents are constantly changing, controlling through chaos, and there's not a family calendar, and there's not a family schedule, and just kids don't know what they're going to do the next day, and if they make plans, those get undone. Parents will just up and control through chaos, cut the kid off right in the middle of the computer game, shock parenting, and plans never pan out. So just, you got to lie in order to survive. You don't think about tomorrow because it's not going to happen anyway. And that's conditioned antisocial. That's my opinion. I haven't read about it. I just had that opinion on my own. So antisocial, then there's borderline, borderline disorder is a borderline between two other disorders that I don't understand anything about. That's why it's called borderline. It doesn't mean you're like borderline emotional. It's not. Borderline means, like in the Shrink Bible, there's these two other disorders and borderline personality disorders between those others. And you got to know what those others are. But basically borderline disorder is many short-lived, intense, dramatic relationships. That's the best way that I can see it. Super neurotic. Happy 1 minute, one little thing happens, sets them off. I'm your best friend. What? You know, and that all happened within like 30 seconds. And it's like, that's maybe my lay opinion of borderline. Histrionic. I do believe my grandmother, my crazy grandmother that I always didn't talk about, played piano. I believe she was histrionic. Life was a stage for her, and she never got out of character. And she kept performing in order to make people follow her. And she kept going to a point at the end of her life where she pretended to be depressed to try to blackmail us into feeling sorry for her. My half uncle visited us for Christmas morning. The only time he ever did. He was there for Christmas. Christmas morning, she calls. She's so sad that we're there and she can't control us from Seattle. We're in Michigan. And she said, I think I'm going to kill myself. I don't think I want to live anymore. That's how I've actually fooled my dad with her voice in the house. And like, we've had laughs in the family over that. That's how she sounded. And she'd called like three or four times threatening suicide. And my father finally said, Mom, I need to know something. Are you really going to kill yourself? I need to know if this is a joke or if you're really planning to do it. And she was silent. And he said, if you're really planning to kill yourself, then I need to call the sheriff's department and have them go to the house and stop you from it. So I need you to tell me right now, do you really plan to kill yourself or not? Well, don't know. He said, okay, well, I'm glad to hear that because I love you. And we're here with Christmas morning and we will talk to you again. And I love you very much. Goodbye. Now, that's not the way to handle suicide stuff, but she was coming from what I think maybe is histrionic, the histrionic personality disorder. But I don't think she was ever diagnosed, but eventually she kept pretending to be more and more depressed. She worked herself into a state of real depression, and Dad had to file guardianship for her. She missed her court date, which could be contempt of court. But instead, my dad and half uncle gave the judge an earful about what, you know, see what we're talking about. Judge said, yeah, she's crazy. They took her into custody, locked her away into a retirement community. Very nice home she lived in the rest of her days. They sold her house to pay the community she lived in. I believe she was histrionic. And I've got stories I'll tell about her. But I came to the conclusion of maybe histrionic, maybe. Just reading about personality disorders on my own. Now, I don't know if you can hear a sound in the background. That's the monsoon rain. In fact, you know what I'm going to do? I think I'm going to do another podcast here with the monsoon rain with a window open. Because everyone's worried about, Jesse, are you okay in that monsoon? It's 3 weeks of rain. It kind of comes and goes, but it gets really intense at times. In cluster B, the other personality disorder is, the fourth, is narcissism. And this is where there's a lady, I don't want to say who, but I genuinely believe she could be narcissistic. Everything is all about her. And it's to a point of crazy. And you can look that up. I could say a lot, but I'll spare you. But narcissism, just everything has to be about them. Everything's got to be about this. Everyone's got to pay attention to them. Histrionic is similar. It's all in cluster B. That's the dramatic theatric cluster. And then the last cluster is the codependent relationship type of thing. I know the last two are avoidant and dependent. Oh, OCD. Obsessive compulsive. And this is about the control codependent cluster C. Obsessive compulsive is not Scott Turner, what's his name, the actor from Turner and Hooch. Oh, come on, he did Castaway. Tom Hanks. That's not obsessive compulsive, Turner and Hooch. Super, super clean. That's not obsessive compulsive. Obsessive compulsive is about micromanaging and controlling people. It's about fear of loss of control. Obsessive compulsive boss will micromanage and control super, super clean stuff in order to control everything. I have to have control. And they do this to meddle with people and to control people and into. And the thing, avoidant is they avoid everything, like they're addicted to it. Dependent is they're dependent on people, like they need someone to be helping them. And avoidant is they avoid anyone helping them, but it's an avoiding way. So you can study more of that on your own. The thing about a personality disorder is that a personality disorder, that one of the market flags that sets it off in my mind, just as someone that's, again, just having seen and talked and dealt with people and what makes sense to me as a non-professional. I really hope that if you know a professional, or if you are a professional YouTuber, I hope that you say more about what I'm talking about and fill in the blanks if I'm an idiot. I just want to talk about the general knowledge. I don't want to pretend to be an expert, but I've got ideas and I want to help society. That's why I'm talking about this. And I've got a theory about Eastern shame culture that it's a collection of personality disorders. And I think that could really help a lot of people to understand it that way. The thing about a personality disorder, one, I mean, it's enduring, it's inflexible, it's maladaptive, it's disturbing, and it impairs social functioning. That's the Myers, that's what I got from the Myers psychology book. They never change. They might comply if a gun's held to their head, but they'll emotionally melt down doing so, and they'll stay that way. They cannot adapt or learn. They can't figure it out. They'll never change. And the second thing is, they're addicted to chaos. Now, that phrase comes from my father telling me about a Samuel L. Jackson movie, I do believe. And I need to go back and find it out. But in a movie, as my father explains this to me, which I need to go see, I'm saying this because I give credit where due. Samuel L. Jackson supposedly said to someone, "You're not, you know, such and whatever. You're addicted to chaos." And so, giving credit where due. Personality disorders, everyone I've ever seen, my grandmother would do this. And so the other lady I think of narcissism would do this. And the two ladies I know, I believe my landlady in Taiwan is PPD, paranoid. She's just so hateful. And I know another lady who's paranoid, a lovely lady, very nice, but just has a problem. But my landlady, I really believe, is a very bad person. So I know two people with PPD. One of them, I think, is a good person who needs help. The other person is a bad person that needs help. So all of them, they can only go so long before they need to have their chaos. They can only go so long. Things can only be good for so long before some switch flips in their subconscious mind, or something in the back of their brain. I don't want to use subconscious jargon. Somewhere in the back of their brain, they're not aware of it. Something flips and they've got to destabilize and create problems. They just can't have relationships continue for a long time. Mental health is about being productive, which basically is prosperity, profitability. You contribute to society. That's the financial term for that is profitability. Your life is profitable. You're lifting. You're not leaning. You're lifting. Being productive and having a kind of sort of more or less happy-ish life, so to speak. And you have relationships that last. That's basically kind of a layman synopsis of what mental health is. And personality disorders can't do that because things can only go on for so long before they've got to create get their chaos fix. And they'll go back to one of those old relationships that's broken and they'll try to bring it in because they need to go restore the relationship so they can break it again to get their chaos fix. And they never break the pattern, never. Now, I've got this other theory. Like, I'm not sure. I don't want to get into whether demons are involved in this and sin. Like you've got to be really an idiot and a bad person to get to the point of that. But I don't know. I've been discussing that with another therapist on Minds.com, the Christian discussion group. I was discussing some of that. Those theories with him. But I'm not sure because I'm not an expert on that. But I wonder if personality disorders can involve not demon possession, but like someone does something bad and demons kind of like that and gravitate, get obsessed with that person. And that person keeps welcoming it. And eventually they're like locked in and they can't stop doing this. I wonder, but I'm not sure. I'm not sure. That's not a main point. I really hope I'm not distracted because I don't want to defend that. That's just kind of a little Jesse fart thought in the back of my mind. But the big theory I've got is that personality disorders explain Eastern shame culture. And mainly, it's one from cluster A, two from cluster B, and all three from cluster C. It's not schizoid and schizotypal. That's family worship where people believe there's a ghost in the house. Or their dead grandmother talked to them and told them that they're not allowed to go outside. I actually know a kid here who became a stay-at-home mama's boy because they believe grandma was possessed by a ghost and said he can't go outside. So now we're talking maybe schizotypal or schizoid. I don't know. But that's kind of weird and religious. But we're talking paranoid disorder, PPD, maybe, or at least what looks like it, what could be. We're talking borderline and antisocial from cluster B. There could be a little bit of histrionic or some narcissism, but the shame culture recipe, borderline and antisocial. And that's sort of that indirection thing where lots of lying very easily, kind of a distant cousin of antisocial, but there's other antisocial stuff going on. Antisocial and borderline, PPD, from cluster A, antisocial and borderline, and then all three of cluster C. Obsessive compulsive, which is about the controlling boss. Avoidant, they'll just like, if I make a mistake, I won't talk to you for 3 months. And I'm not mad. I don't know how to show my face. I can't face my problems. I've got to avoid them. And then dependent. I need my mother to always be caring for me. I need my boss to always be looking after me. I need everyone on the street to interrupt me and stop what I'm doing. Everyone has to do it or it won't work, to tell me to not slip on the wet tiles in Asia, because I know you watch that video and everybody's got